Last time I see a sofa like yours on the motorway, we got called to an accident and we've gone out there. There's an Indian gentleman. The ill was being taken back to the airport, so going back to India. And the family has put him on the settee in the back of the sofa in the back of the van, transit van. And it was in collision in the fast lane of the motorway, and the back doors had burst open. He came out and he was down the fast lane on a sofa, and that was a lot worse than it happened to you.
Was he dead?
No, he wasn't.
Then it wasn't worse.
Went out to one accident where an Indian chappie had was driving along, and he must have dropped his cigarette on the front seat, and it caught the seater light. And as he's trying to put it out, he's gone off the side of the motorway and he's run along the embankment. He had a can of petrol in the vehicle with him, and on impact, the petrol spilled, and it was sort of immediate. The whole car went up in flames and burned him to death in the car. And then, once we recovered the vehicle back to Coddington, the police came up because they'd lost his watch, and I sifted the ashes in the floor of the car, found the watch, and while I was finding the watch, I found all the finger bones from his hand. And not taking too much notice of them, I picked the finger bones up and I got one of the lads out in the workshop and said to him, "You're good at puzzles." And I pieced the finger bones together on his hand. And it took him a little while to realise what it was.
So it was an exciting life.
Yeah. When you hear the police go down the motorway with a siren going, you know there's an RTA, and everybody starts...
What's an RTA?
Road traffic accident.
How do you mend with your lingo?
And everybody then starts running about and starting the vehicles up ready just in case, because other people get the accidents as well as us on the motorway. But
you want to get there first.
Yeah, that's right.
You're sort of like the vultures of the highway, aren't you?
Well, you're not
supposed to. I mean, you sort of sniff a corpse out and there you are, buzzing around.
That's just how it goes with the type of job we're doing. I mean, we earn a living out of people having misfortune.
But what really upsets you, you know, if it's not taking arms and legs off the side of the road?
Well, that doesn't upset me half as much as some of the people that we deal with, the general public that come into our place. And they tend to think that we're ripping them off. And what they don't appreciate is with the staff we've got there, the hours we have to work, and it's open 24 hours, 7 days a week. And they seem to think that we can do that for nothing, and they start demanding their cars without payment, and all sorts goes on all day long. I mean, it comes to the end of the day, when you go home, you end up banging your head on the door to a bit of relief after dealing with those sort of people. And that is the worst side of it, rather than the accident side.
That's worse than picking up the
That's
fingers.
Right, yeah, that is, definitely. Because we don't get any complaints and we don't get any backlash off of the other people we take off the motorway.
Well, they're quiet. I mean, they sort of wish they are.
This is it. We're here now.
This is where I'm doing my show.
Looks like it. Are you going free for a few minutes?
Why free?
Yeah. We're looking for guests for a chat show. And wondered if you'd like to go on the Ruby Wax programme.
Not really, thank you.
She's a very nice lady.
No, thank you.
Hello. I'm looking for people to come on a chat show. For Ruby Wax.
Definitely not right, thank you.
Why?
I don't like it.
Oh.
Sorry, Spotty. We're looking for people for the Ruby Wax chat show, and I wonder if we could pick
up. Oh, wait. Just give me a look. We need to keep this show.
You ever heard of Ruby Wax? You ever heard of Ruby Wax? No? Oh, never mind. Oh, Too late.
Excuse me. We're filming a chat show for Channel 4, a lady called Ruby Wax. And she's a really nice lady. No, honestly, she is.
Oh, really?
She is.
Hi, excuse me. We're looking for a guest on the Ruby Wax show. Will you come on?
Ruby Wax?
Yeah. She's an American comedian. She's got a chat show. Will you come and be a guest?
I can't stand the woman.
Come on, then. Don't take that.
Send her back to the stage where she comes from. Very awful.
I'm not a fan of hers.
You mean you don't like it?
I don't like the shows very much.
I'm a big. Sorry. Yeah. See you later.
Okay.
Excuse me, are you, do you want to be famous? We've got this lovely lady called Ruby Wax. She'd like you on a show, like someone famous, beautiful, like you.
So you're not interested in coming on the show?
Yeah, I'm not interested in coming on the show. You're joking.
But, excuse me, I wonder if you could be a guest on Ruby Wax's chat show. Ruby Wax, will you...
Please come on the show, we need some guests.
If I could just have a few minutes of your time.
Yes, sir.
That would be really nice. Yes. We've had some problems.
You have?
Yes. I've had some problems.
Oh, I see.
So if just give me a few minutes, that would... Thank you. And your name is...
Mr. Josie.
Mr. Josie.
John, yes.
John. You work at the Welcome Break?
Yes.
And your function here?
Cleaner. Yes, yes.
And what particular items?
Well, I do the car. It's a car park cleaner, actually. That's the official title. Yeah.
Do you use a broom?
Occasionally, yes.
Any other instruments?
Well, I use the bin liners. Yeah.
Right. Anything? Any other instruments I might not be expecting?
No.
The broom and the bin liners.
Yeah, that's it.
Any hobbies?
Yes.
And what would that be?
I like art. Interested,
pardon me?
Interested in art.
Art.
Yeah.
You are a painter?
Well, I try to be.
What do you paint, Joe?
Well, I've painted portraits, and I've taught myself to paint animals, actually.
Animals?
Yeah.
What particular animal?
The Hereford.
Hereford,
yes. That's the cattle. That's the breed.
The breed of the cattle.
Yes. The Shire horse.
You paint cows?
Yes. And there's a Clydesdale. That's another breed.
So you see the cow in the pasture, and then you just... How do you get him to pose?
You can do that, but or you can do it like from photographs.
Oh.
There's two methods, you see.
A lot of cows or just one cow?
Well, two or three in a picture.
Do you live by yourself?
Yes.
Do you have any pets there?
A cat.
Oh.
Yeah.
How many cats have you got?
Well, 14, but never one has come back. That makes 15.
Was there a wife, or was she eaten by the cat?
No, never been married.
You haven't?
No.
You're a bachelor man.
That's right.
Did you ever have a girlfriend?
Well, some time ago, yeah.
When was that?
About 52.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's sort of a gap.
Quite a way back.
What happened?
Well, I just said, can I see you to the station? I was very nervous, of course.
Yes.
Never having had a girlfriend before. I tried this method. I thought I'd plucked up courage. And then she just said she didn't like men.
She didn't like men?
Yeah. So what do? You just go, don't you? If she doesn't like men, well, I took off.
Well, I think... Makes sense. Well, thank you for being on the show.
Pardon?
Thank you.
Thanks.
What's next? The research is on what? My next guest was brought to me straight from the Star petrol pump, Kate Boxall, bomb disposal officer. Kate, when did you realize that you were there to put away bombs?
I got into it purely by accident. It was just a posting to an engineer unit, and it just so happened to be the bomb disposal unit. So I didn't choose to do it at all. The title of the unit is 33 Engineer Regiment, EOD.
Right.
And a couple of months before I went there, I realised what the EOD stood for, and that's Explosive Ordnance Disposal. In other words, bomb disposal.
Did you think you were just going to do some light paperwork?
Yes.
So most people would quit at this point.
No, I think it's a chance to do something completely unusual. Nobody else that you come across has done it before.
No girlies have ever.
No, I was the first woman bomb disposal officer in the army.
Yeah. Really?
Mm-hmm.
And how did they train you to go to the bomb? Or you just kind of
very carefully. Just a matter of learning within the classroom about the bombs, about the various pieces of ordnance, because of course it isn't just bombs, it's anything from rockets through mortars to just small arms ammunition. So it's everything. Once you've learned about it, the hardest thing probably is to recognise what you're dealing with. Of course you can't deal with it until you've identified it.
You have to look it up in the manual to identify what it is, and this, you're staying calm through all this?
That's what you're trying to do.
Why don't you just throw yourself in an oncoming car? Seriously.
Because then the odds are stacked well against me.
Well, I think
and nothing's in my hands then. Whereas so when it's me and a bomb, then it's purely down to me, isn't it?
But what would make you really jump? Not a loud noise.
No, I don't think so. Heights are just the thing that... Oh, and injections. I'm not too good on either.
You scared of injections?
Yes. There's a confession.
Yeah. Do they know that in the army? I mean, if you were captured, they would just stick a needle in you. You confess it all.
I guess we can't say that on television.
No, I don't think we can.
No, forget that she was on the show.
Who's the enemy then, do you think? Who are you fighting?
Well, you've got to, if you want an answer to that, then I'm not the first to ask, am I, really? If you want to talk about world politics, then
no,
the,
I don't want to talk about world politics,
strategic,
but who would you,
answer.
Who, you don't have any specific enemy then?
No, anyone who would want to deny me of my rights. Yeah.
Right.
Which, at any one time, you know, the politicians or the, you know, the generals assess who that particular enemy is. Obviously, it changes from day to day.
So aren't you sort of redundant in hanging around until there's a war?
Not at all, no. We're obviously, as an operational regiment, we already have 45 years' work on the books. If we don't find anything else and if we never go to war again. And that's just clearing up...
You mean we're sitting on bombs now?
It isn't quite that bad. But obviously, as they dig up the Docklands, the development there, then they do keep on turning up wartime bombs. There are areas which have been used...
all you estate agents. Look out. You know, you have all this training. You have all this training, you know, that gets you over your fear of heights and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So now you really respect yourself a lot, right?
Well, perhaps not a lot, but every time you achieve something else,
let's say 10 out of 10.
A little bit better. Yeah.
So now the bomb is ticking away and you walk over and the bomb goes off and you're blown to smithereens. Where did that training get you?
Well, it meant it was you and not somebody else, I suppose.
Really? God, I'm much more selfish than that. Okay, thank you for being on the show.
We'll be right back.
Well, that was Roberto Pla, live from the granary.
How much more time do we have to kill?
No, we did try it. Oh, isn't it?
Where?
Well.
I hear you, psychic.
Yeah.
And am I going to die soon? What do you see?
Well, I wouldn't have thought so about looking at you. No. Not just yet.
But what do you have, a blinding flash of light or what?
No, it's not quite that dramatic, really. It's more mental impressions.
You get it right?
Most of the time, yeah.
When did you get it wrong?
I remember once doing a reading for a lady, and I was saying to her that I felt her son would be going into business and that he would be changing his business, going into a different career. And she turned around to me and she said, he's only five. And it was like, oh, Christ.
Do you get your money back then if you're wrong?
No, because I went on to give her what was actually going on within her life, so that was all right eventually.
Are you freaked? Aren't you nervous? Do you get...
Not at that level.
What's your gift?
I sometimes read cards for people, and at times actually I'm able to actually speak with the people's dead relatives.
You mean suddenly your mouth opens and...
You have to prepare yourself, and then I would breathe and do a meditation beforehand, and then then the person would just speak through me.
You can also get what they call transfiguration, which is when the medium's face actually alters.
Her face changes?
Yeah, that's right, that's called transfiguration.
Not always like this, really.
I mean, she suddenly grows a beard, or what happens?
Well, yeah, I mean, it can happen to anybody who opens up as a medium.
Have you seen her do it?
Well, yeah. We've seen things on each other's faces.
Lots of things.
How do you know each other?
Andrew lives in the flat above me.
Oh, you lived in the same house?
Yeah, that's right.
Do you have kind of vibrations between the floors and things?
Oh, lots of vibrations.
I mean,
there
can be.
They have fights.
Oh, psychic fights?
Psychic battles.
Oh, no, tell me what.
One day we fell out over something which was quite trivial. It wasn't a teabag, it was a cat, actually.
More important.
And I took it upon myself to attack them in a psychic way. So I decided to use a curse at the clinic, made a doll and things like that.
Made a what?
A doll.
Right.
And what I was asking for was I wanted fire around her, right? And less than 12 hours later, Linus was travelling.
She what?
She wrote a car off. She was travelling down on the motorway. And she wrote a car off. That was within 12 hours of having done what I did. And then I altered that to death by drowning, I think it was.
Death by what?
Drowning.
Death by drowning. What actually happened was my washer is above Linus's cloakroom. And the seals all bust on the washer. It was quite amazing. So there was water flooding through the floors.
Well, I'd already picked up that Andrew was playing about psychically. So I'd taken steps to ensure that anything that Andrew sent to me went back to him.
Would you curse his hairdryer? No, what did you do? Make a doll of him?
No. I surrounded myself with light.
Did it occur to you that you might be crazy?
No.
It didn't.
Quite honest.
It's just a thought.
Well, yeah. No, it didn't.
Well, when you actually see it happening,
well, yeah.
You know, there's no way you can think you're crazy.
I mean, all right, you can interpret the different mental impressions that you get as possibly being schizophrenia, if you like. Yeah, I mean, I can accept that for some people. But no, seeing a chair fly across the room, I mean, what would you think?
I'd call an ambulance. I wouldn't start charging. Do you all work together psychically then?
We can do. We have done it in the past, and we do occasionally on certain things. Yeah, we all tune in.
Do you all get together and chant? Or?
We have done
it
in the past.
Yes.
We have done. I mean, that's not how we would normally, work is too strong a word, how we'd be together psychically. It's usually just a question of tuning into someone or a situation, and the other two having a go tuning into something and picking something up.
Well, you guys are like radios.
Yes.
Is there something evil about all this? I mean, have you been involved in
evil
stuff?
Oh, yes, there can be. There are a lot of people on the psychic scene who are into black activities, that's what it's called, satanic covens. And they do an awful lot of work at night. governed by the phases of the moon. They work together. And because at the moment there's no control or legislation over psychic activities whatsoever or psychic groups meeting, they can do more or less what they like. And what they tend to be is like little mini dictatorships. They're ruled usually by the one guy who leads the coven. And he sets the policy for the coven, who they're going to attack, what they're going to do. And the one coven that I knew of, I was attacked by that coven because the attempt was to recruit me to join it.
Do what?
Well, to participate in their activities.
Which is what?
Well, basically, they raise power, which they then use for whatever purpose they want to. The raising of power comes largely through sexual activities. So you have sex magic.
How do they do it?
Well, they have sex.
And what? And somebody's car crashes?
Yeah. That's exactly how it works. What it is, you have sex and you raise power. But as you'll be having sex, you wouldn't be thinking sexually. You'd be maintaining in your head a vision of the object you wanted to achieve. Because if you wanted a car crash, while you were having it away, you'd be imagining a car crashing. Now, what normally happens...
And if it doesn't work, you have to try it again.
You have to try it again.
Yeah. And so go ahead, yeah. So.
Yeah, well, what usually happens is that that kind of thing goes on in the group. A number of people are raising power, and they are visualizing that. Then there's the headman who will, or the woman, who will then actually direct the power, and she will, as it were, gather up a cone of power, all this energy.
Is this going on in England?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
People are all having sex. How many are we talking here?
We're talking thousands and thousands of people. Every town will have at least half a dozen covens, almost certainly, at least. And that's working in organized groups.
Can I just add something there? That not all covens and not all groups are black.
Oh, no.
No, right. No, I'm just interested in the black one.
Yeah. Well, right. The black one.
No. Yeah, I'm sure some people, you know, do flower arranging, but we need to know what goes on in these things. Yeah. So is there a guy with the horns?
Yep. Yeah. Well, they use all the ritual paraphernalia in order to give them a kind of high. It's part of the dramatic setting, right? It changes them from being ordinary people, perhaps like around a table in a service station, to being in a magical environment, a charged state. So they will do other things, like they'll drink blood or they'll sacrifice animals. I was being groomed at one point for goat's blood. I was being groomed to participate. I was being psychically...
What, you were doing the catering? What?
No, I was being worked upon psychically. I was being opened up. Our energy was being transmitted to me.
Somebody called you?
Yeah.
And said, I want you for Satan?
Yeah.
On the phone? Where did they call you?
Oh, well, not on the phone. Through the psychic, through the airwaves, yeah. You see, when they set about trying to woo you, as it were, into their sphere of influence, things go very well for you. But your job seems to go very well. There's an awful lot of positive energy put around you. You might get contracts, you might get people that you want to meet and have difficulty meeting might suddenly reappear, or you might buy a house. You get bargains. Things go very well for you and you think it's great knowing these people. It's really good. Fine people, it's very good. And then when you fall out with them, things go the other way. That's when the attack starts. You start having nightmares, accidents start to happen to people.
What happened to you?
What happened to me was everyone around me got hit in some way. All the people got hit. Car accidents, illness, loss of jobs, a whole series of things around me went wrong. I personally was interfered with through dreams and energy every night for about 2 years. But I knew what was happening. Most people who are under attack don't know what's happening.
So how did you ward off Mr. Evil Spirit?
Well, there are certain things you can do psychically for yourself, but eventually I called out for someone and that's when I met Glynis. It's not just a question of dreams. I mean, if it was just a question of dreams, that's neither here nor there. But there are physical phenomena. And at one point, a lamppost was chopped down outside the house. Now, the guy who was doing this, his coven, was meeting some almost 200 miles away, and yet they managed to chop down a lamppost. And that's, when you're talking about psychic power, you're talking about something quite dramatic there.
And we thought that it had actually been hit by a car. I mean, you don't expect the lamppost to fall down on its own, but the people came from technical services where we live, and they said to Glynis, look, lampposts just don't fall down. But it had, and it had not been hit, and they found it had not been hit, like by the way it had fallen and everything else.
Well, I mean, although it's an horrific thing to take into account in the modern world, accidents are not always accidents, and that's not in the sense of a Freudian thing that we generate our own misfortune. It can be generated by others using psychic energy. It's a real, tangible force, and it works.
If they're so powerful, can they change the mind of people in power?
Oh, yes, they do. There are covens devoted in large part to attacking politicians, and politicians are sublimely unaware of this. And there will certainly be, in Whitehall, civil servants involved in black magic activities, and certainly in the city. Power is what it's all about. These people don't dance about, they don't chant for the kicks. Now, some of them do, the little people do. Some of them will be involved for the sex. The top people do it for power. Power is what they're about. It's what they worship.
This is if you believe in it.
Well, if you believe in it. You haven't experienced it.
No.
I believe that psychic attacks is one of the last closet secrets of our culture, and that people around the country who are under psychic attack will not talk to other people because they are afraid to do so for ridicule or feelings that it won't be recognised. And I feel if the number of people who were under psychic attack actually began to talk about it, you would not then ask that kind of question. You would realise it's a very general phenomenon. I also believe that there are people in covens who are afraid to leave those covens for fear of what will happen to them, having seen what covens themselves can do.
What about if somebody tries to get out of the coven?
They get you, because they very often take samples of your blood and hair.
How do
and
they get
keep
you?
Them. Well, they attack you.
Well, what happens? People crazy? Do you run under cars?
Well, usually, that it could be that. It could well be that. The most likely thing, though, is that members of your family, your circle, are attacked first. These people who run these things are very mean. And they will go for the weakest people first. And if you're a mother and you became involved in a coven when you were 19 and yet when you're 25 you want to leave, they may decide that they want to keep you in because you're of use to them. And they will then threaten your children. And your children will start to feel ill.
Okay. I'll be all right, though. Will I live to tell this tale?
Well, hopefully. The question is, will you live very long afterwards?
Well, I hope they don't burn you at the stake, especially you. Thanks for being on the show. Thank you for watching the show, wherever we've been. And if that bus doesn't hit that highway soon, I'm going to be presenting next week's show, Swinging from a Noose, Nighty Night. Are those ballroom dancers still here? Maybe I can get a lift with them. Does anybody have something fattening I can eat? I got to chomp on something. God.
That. So, sorry, my lover, can I just butt in for a second?
Yeah.
It's not that you haven't got a lovely voice. You have got a lovely voice, and I could listen to
Thank
it, your
you.
Lovely voice forever. And sometimes I feel like I have. I guess that we've been here for some time now, and I think some of the people would like me, maybe, to introduce one of the great programs we got on over the evening.
Oh, bless them. I think that'd be fair. Why don't you do the next one, then?
All right, then. What's coming up next, then, my lover?
The adverts. Oh,
God.
Put your heart on it.